the next presentation is going to focus on indigenous cultural heritage and history in New Hampshire. We have three presenters. It's truly a collaborative endeavor right here, right now, to be able to negotiate three voices. So we have Jeffrey Barron, he's a previous presentation, Riley Voss, and Miss Elizabeth Schwanner. Did I pronounce it right?
Very good.
So there you go. You can try to see if it works.
That's the wrong way. All
right. There we go. Excellent. Thank you very much. So busy.
All right. Our greetings. My name is Riley Voss.
I'm Jeffrey Barron.
And I'm Libby.
And we are here to present the Indigenous New Hampshire Project. This presentation is an outcome of the Indigenous New Hampshire internship that the three of us took with Professor Peshkova in the Department of Anthropology during this academic year. The main goals of this internship are to preserve Native American culture and history and to provide a resource for public education. History has been silenced the indigenous populations, resulting in the loss of rich details and history and cultural heritage. That's why collaborative efforts such as this internship are key to success of this project. We treat silenced indigenous perspectives as historical evidence, which result in a better understanding of our state and country's history. We want to revive indigenous experiences and voices so that everyone has access to these. On the slide, you can see the current participants. One outcome of our project is the Story Map Journal, which is a digital application by ArcGIS's ESRI. It uses geospatial science technology to create maps anyone can build on. Our map displays local New Hampshire sites that have indigenous ties, evaluates the indigenous roles narrativized by non-indigenous people, and explains the context of violence, changes in the land, and the portrayals of indigenous people. The colonists created the state boundaries while the indigenous people divided the land differently. We are used to seeing indigenous people as savage or cruel, which creates history as a map of indigenous violence. Our Story Map Journal has 26 vetted entries. We are currently working on supplementing colonial place names with indigenous names. This prioritizes that indigenous perspective. The indigenous names will come first on the map. We also list all the sources we use so that our readers can access and evaluate our references. The next product is the website, which is about indigenous history, very complex and cannot be fully represented by a couple of paragraphs on a map. Hence, the website provides more detailed descriptions of indigenous culture, food, and heritage. On this site, we aim to publish tabs with different subjects such as for kids, culture, problematic, and so on in the future. By providing critical lenses on existing stereotypes, this website serves as a reliable source for public education. In this project, we have used the following methods: archival research, conducting interviews, reviewing sources, collaborating with people of different backgrounds and experiences, and content analysis. Our working progress starts by giving the collaborators the topic we are going to write about. They help look for the sources, we do the research, send them a write-up, they make the edits, and then we publish. Our team highlights the indigenous side so that we can best represent their voices. When it comes to indigenous history, many historical narratives available to us are one-sided. These narratives are not accurate per se, but do not offer multiple perspectives on history and often silence the indigenous one. The fewer number of sides we listen to, the further away we are from the truth. Multiple viewpoints create a space for discussion while having several people help weed out the myths, landing us closer to a truth.
In order to better understand the history of New Hampshire, we first had to understand the history of the country as a whole in a broader context. Far too often, our historical narratives, as Riley mentioned, are incomplete and one-sided. American history is usually taught as having begun with Christopher Columbus's voyage across the Atlantic Ocean. The continent would be called the New World by explorers and settlers, but for the people who've been living here for millennia, this land was anything but new. The first Americans arrived at least 15,000 years ago, and probably as far back as 30,000 years ago. They crossed into America via Beringia, which connected Northeast Asia with Alaska. At the time that the first Americans were moving into North America, what is now called New Hampshire was inhabitable. The Laurentide Ice Sheet extended from the Canadian Rockies in the west all the way to the east coast, and at its maximum 20,000 years ago, as far south as northern Pennsylvania. But by around 12,500 years ago, the ice sheet had retreated far enough that New Hampshire became exposed. The first people to inhabit what we now call New Hampshire were the Paleo Indians. They lived as nomadic hunter-gatherers, and their territories extended throughout much of the Northeast, where they would travel seasonally in search of food. Their primary source of food was possibly caribou, which migrated across the state in large herds. The next phase of occupation was the Archaic period, which lasted until about 3,000 years ago. During this time, the climate warmed up slightly, leading to an increase in the diversity and abundance of food sources, as well as starting the shift towards a more settled lifestyle. The final pre-contact phase in New Hampshire was the Woodland period, which was marked by the discovery of an important technology, agriculture. The discovery of agriculture led to an increase in overall population and continued the shift towards a more sedentary lifestyle. At that time, people started to live in larger semi-permanent villages, which are called odina in the Abenaki language. In the final days before European contact, the total population of North America could have been as high as 50 million people. The first explorers brought with them a deadly and invisible weapon, disease. By the time the first permanent European settlements were established, as much as 90% of the indigenous population had been killed off by diseases. As settlers pushed west, they found a land without people for a people without land. The roads and plowed fields that had been created by the Native Americans were found empty. The settlers took this as a sign that God had prepared this land for them. The indigenous perspective was silenced, and history was written from an exclusively colonial perspective.
One of the primary goals of this internship is addressing the modern stereotypes and myths about Indigenous people. These stereotypes are often reinforced by what is taught in schools and presented in popular culture. For example, the story of Thanksgiving often taught in schools about pilgrims and Indians working together is greatly falsified. The racist portrayal of Indigenous people in Peter Pan is another example of how stereotypes can become ingrained in children. Though its inaccurate portrayals have been identified and condemned, the film is still very popular, and schools still put on productions of the musical. These are just two of thousands of examples that show why this project is necessary. This project aims to foster respect, recognition, and understanding for the Indigenous people of New Hampshire. There are still no federally recognized tribes in New Hampshire, which often leads to the assumption that no Indigenous people live in this state. However, there are still thousands of Indigenous people living here. We also hope to preserve Indigenous philosophies, oral history, art, food, and music by making this knowledge freely available online. By recording these histories, we hope to reframe the current colonized version of history to include the significant impacts Indigenous people have had on the history of New Hampshire and the country as a whole. This project also affects non-Indigenous communities in New Hampshire. We release only reliable, vetted information, which is free for public access. This information has been gathered into websites that are easy to use and to access. We provide references to our sources so that interested viewers can explore the material even further. Through this project, we hope to dismantle the harmful stereotypes we see in the history books and media today. As part of our public outreach, we are creating a curriculum for public schools to provide students with an accurate, decolonized understanding of Indigenous history. We encourage people to look at cultural practices from the perspective of that culture instead of from their own, and to critically examine existing historical narratives. The story of Hannah Dustin is an example of how colonized history can become distorted. Dustin was captured from her home in Haverhill, Massachusetts by a group of Abenaki in 1697, along with her nurse and newborn baby. Somewhere along the journey, her infant died, and Hannah would later claim that it was killed by the Abenaki. Hannah eventually encouraged her other captives to attack their captors while they slept. Hannah later killed 10 Abenaki, some of whom were children, and scalped all of them. For hundreds of years, Hannah was lauded as a hero. To most, killing and scalping children while they sleep is not considered heroism. The plaque on her commemorative statue is written from a purely colonial perspective, as you can see. The colonized narratives say that Hannah's baby was murdered by her captors, But from the Indigenous perspective, that is extremely unlikely since they highly value the lives of all children. The story of Hannah Dustin is incredibly complex and we may never know the full truth, but it is important to recognize that the colonized colonial stereotypes of the savage Indian have distorted the facts. Hopefully we have demonstrated how restoring the Indigenous perspective to historical narratives can be beneficial to both Indigenous and non-Indigenous people. Since this is an interdisciplinary and collaborative project, we hope to both draw from and positively impact the whole community. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. So we have time for questions. If there are any. Jasmine's mom. I'm just curious, how would you present it to school boards to put this in their curriculum?
We're starting to work with the education department, and we are not education students, so I'm not totally sure, but we are working with people that would know how to present that. There's an example of at Durham High School, I believe, where they're teaching a course on American history that takes a third of the year from the African American perspective, a third from the Indigenous perspective, and a third from women's perspective. So I'm sure we could base something off that and use that as an example of how it's working.
One of our goals is to come up with K through 12 for New Hampshire schools to give them a guidance on Indigenous history and incorporating it into their curriculum.
And we recently added a new intern from the education department, and we were working with her in order to create these curriculums and make them freely available online for teachers to access.
When I went to college in California, I had to learn about, I grew up in the East, but when I went to college in California, I had to learn about all the migration from Russia to, North America, and no one on this side of the country knows any of that. So when you put that map up there, I thought, oh, I'm back in college again, but that's the Western side of the country learning that, not here. It's very, very different and culturally from the East and the West in this country.